again, I'm Jane Wales. I'm CEO of the World Affairs Council. This afternoon, we'll be talking to Ray Suarez. Most of you know Ray from not only from his appearances at the World Affairs Council, for which we're always grateful, but know him for his period as an anchor and as a national correspondent on the Lair NewsHour, later now known as the NewsHour. Actually, when I started watching, it was the McNeil Lair NewsHour, but now. But Ray now has his own program called Inside Story on Al Jazeera America, and we're looking forward to seeing him in that news outlet as well. Before he was at PBS, he was at National Public Radio, and he was the anchor for All Things Considered. Of Talk of the Nation, which is what I used to listen to at noontime, a wonderful show, and he did that for 6 years. He was previously at CNN, and he was the most appealing job he ever had was with CBS Radio in Rome, just because it was in Rome. You can't complain
right.
about that.
You end the workday and you're in Rome, so it's a lot to be said for that.
He has won all kinds of awards. He was inducted into the National Association of Hispanic Journalists Hall of Fame. He's co-recipient of the Alfred DuPont-Columbia Awards for NPR's coverage of large stories like the first multiracial elections in South Africa, as well as the first 100 days of the 104th Congress here in the United States. He's the author of several books. I think last time Ray was here, he was talking to us about his book on religion and politics in America. His latest book is entitled Latino Americans, and it came out alongside a PBS documentary.
See, now that I'm in commercial broadcasting again, I can just hold it up as an endorsement.
But what's interesting is that this book, not only can you get this book right outside afterwards, signed by Ray, but also it's accompanied by a PBS documentary series on the same topic that was put out in 2013, September of 2013. So please join me in welcoming Ray Suarez.
Thank you.
Now, I'm going to open the conversation with a little bit of conversation about journalism itself, then move to a couple of the stories that you've been covering or have covered recently that are on the minds of our audience, and then finally turn to the topic of your book. So starting with journalism, give us a sense of what you think the future of journalism is as you look at the business of journalism, and therefore the future of our own democracy, to the extent that shared decision-making depends on shared knowledge.
A working, credible news business with a sustainable business model is as vital to this country and to democracy as oxygen is to an organism. You really can't have a population that's asked to do the work of being a citizen in the 21st century without sources of credible information that meshes with the other things that people know about the world to create a coherent picture. You know, I could just sort of hit you with bullets or confetti of information, but unless it's presented in a way that you can create a rational portrait of the world you live in from the information I'm giving you, it's not really that useful. So the business, Jane, I have to say, has transformed beyond all recognition from the one I first drew a paycheck in as a copy boy in 1976. That world is dead like it never existed. Peculiar historical realities created ABC, NBC, and CBS. And my first big boss, I brought him the morning troop movements of where ABC correspondents were all around the world, big pile of Xeroxed paper. And I told him that it was my last week and that I was moving on. And he said, in the course of our conversation, you know, God only made three networks and he isn't making any more. And when he said that, nobody could have imagined cable penetration north of 90%. In 1977, he couldn't have imagined the internet, a man who had begun his news career during the Second World War. You couldn't have imagined the graveyard filled with America's afternoon newspapers and now an increasing number of its morning newspapers. You couldn't have imagined that an Australian immigrant could be rocketed to American citizenship by having the skids greased in legal terms so that he could buy the Fox network with all borrowed money. These are things that wouldn't have been possible in another era. So Rupert Murdoch uses a new kind of financing to create a new kind of network. Ted Turner takes what had been a minority source of content. Cable was really only popular in those places where it was hard to get regular television. Even if you put tinfoil on your rabbit ears, the television wasn't going to come in that good. Well, cable moved from 15% penetration to 95% penetration, 93% penetration, and that changed what cable means to us. Well, in the internet, it's destroying my business and building it at the same time. So we're in a moment now where all the old ideas about where the money comes from, what you spend it on when you deploy people and resources for coverage, and then the kind of coverage that you do in order to continue that money coming in, all of those old ideas are right now in renegotiation. It's like trying to rebuild a jet at 35,000 feet somewhere over America without landing. That's what we're doing right now. And when young people in college or just leaving college talk to me about how to get started in the news business, the first thing I tell them is have a very good, plausible plan B. But also that they have to think about their working lives in a very different way from people who were getting into the business. I got in at 19 in 1976 and could see a way ahead of not always doing the same thing, but of putting together jobs like freight cars pulling out of a yard and creating tenure over time in the business. And now I'm an old man, so it worked. It's not going to be that easy. And people will probably drop in and out of the business to do similar kinds of jobs. The idea of going to a company and working there for 40 years, that's, you know, just as it is in other industries, it's dead in the news industry too. I talk to young kids now about brand creation, about being the repository of all their value added, and then selling it to various people who want to buy the skills they have. Right now, and this is not the first time that this has happened, but there are far more people who want to be journalists than can be journalists and make a living at it. The difference is that now, more than ever before, you can actually become a journalist by just deciding that you are one, which is remarkable because there stood between you and an audience in the old days access to a stream of delivery. You had to be able to get what you were writing in the paper. You had to get what you were writing, saying, recording onto a radio station or onto a television station. The doorways were narrow, the gatekeepers were many, and you simply wouldn't create content for nobody to see. Now there are ways for you to be your own content distributor that were unimaginable before the existence of the World Wide Web. So it's destroying and revolutionizing and re-exciting a business that, needs a kick in the behind every now and then. So.
Well, you had to gain access in the good old days, but you also had to meet standards in the good old days. And now there's a shaking out. I mean, the market decides, I guess. But there's a lot of shrieking and howling in between before you sort of get to the kind of serious news coverage that's needed. Say a little bit about, I mean, in the case of Al Jazeera America, they seem to be saying, look, what we're going to focus on is in-depth coverage, what you're lacking, probably with the exception of the Lair NewsHour, tell me, is that the commitment? Are they willing to lose money to live up to that commitment?
Yes.
Tell me about
so
their
far,
business plan.
They bought Al Gore's current TV. Many of you have probably read about this in the papers. They paid a great deal of money for it, in part to gain channel access, to go on the air already with a position amongst the dozens of stations already in your cable package. They believe that there's a future in high-quality TV journalism in America, and they believe that the current state of competition between Fox, MSNBC, and CNN actually leaves a hole in the marketplace. Because those places are properties of much larger media entities that have decided that spending a lot of money on coverage probably doesn't have a guaranteed return, they've realized, as a lot of places have, the cheapest thing to program is talk. So many, many hours of the schedule are filled on those 24-hour cable news channels with people sitting on a set gabbing about the news, rather than people in Simferopol or Kiev or Damascus or New Orleans, where Al Jazeera America is the only network with a bureau in New Orleans covering the reconstruction of an American city. They are convinced that it won't happen right away, but that there is a future, that there is a market share that can be captured and held onto longitudinally for high-quality, in-depth television reporting. Obviously, for selfish reasons, I hope they're right. But I also hope they're right because I've always believed in the existence of a diverse media diet, that nobody reads high-toned, dense news and just that all the time. You need a bonbon every now and then. You need a milkshake along with your kale. And so for there to be a broad and diverse marketplace where you can find out the latest about Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt, if that's your desire, but also find out the latest in the Crimean referendum when that's your desire. We need both those things. And we are all, I mean, I hope we're all, not so dull-witted that we want just Brad Pitt or just Crimean referendum. The world is a fascinating and fun place to know about. And along with your E, exclamation point, you've got Al Jazeera America, and I hope you watch them both.
So here's a question about Al Jazeera America. This questioner asks whether the perception of it being a Middle Eastern, of course it's the Qatar government underwrites it, organization with a Middle Eastern slant.
Well, is the BBC, which broadcasts in a lot of outlets, including KQED here in San Francisco, a British outlet with a British slant on the news? When Martin McGuinness became the deputy prime minister of a new government in Belfast, did you hear a BBC report on that, maybe on the World, on public radio, and say, oh, it's from BBC, forget it, I can't trust them on Northern Ireland? The government of Qatar has a national corporation, as many countries around the world do, that is the holding company for their state properties. Al Jazeera, though best known in much of the world for its English and Arabic channels, actually makes a lot more money broadcasting soccer, which you probably didn't know. And it has the licensing rights to some of the best-known soccer teams in the world in a lot of the developing world. So if you're watching Real Madrid on television, on satellite television in Tunis or Algiers, you're likely watching it on Al Jazeera, though they call it something else, I forget what. So those things are throwing off a lot of money. It's not the emir opening the taps for some more natural gas when I signed on to pay my considerable salary. That's a joke. It's an ongoing, very intelligently positioned world information channel. Whether you're watching Manchester United or watching the uprising in Tahrir Square live over the internet, or watching me at 2 p.m. Pacific or the next day at 8:30, which I know you all will, Pacific, or set your DVRs. Yes, that government interference question is one we get asked. If it's happening, it hasn't reached its cold, deadening finger down to me yet, and I'm an editorial decision maker at Al Jazeera America. I make decisions every day about what's going to be on the air, and if nobody's talking to me, well, maybe they knew I was going to be talking to you, but nobody's talking to me about these things. What I see on the air and what I saw on the air before I signed on convinced me that this is a place of strong news values that are not shaped to the national agendas of one government or one country or another.
Well, my understanding is they've hired some of the best known journalists in this country, and my understanding is they've all been assured that they can control their own content. Let me take you to another point, though. You referred to it as a world news agency, and of course CNN once felt like that as well. One of the first things that happened when folks started cutting back on costs was that they cut back on their foreign correspondents and their bureaus overseas. What do you think the impact is of that? And that's in print media as well, of
sure.
course. So what do you think the impact of that has been for the American consumer of news?
You know, it's not necessarily something that you'd recognize every day, but I think over time it does have an effect. When you close a lot of bureaus and still cover stories in places you had bureaus by parachuting people in, that inevitably leads to a difference in the quality and the depth of the coverage, both on broadcast and in print. You don't have the fine-grained, localized knowledge that you once had. You are, in effect, becoming a 72-hour expert on a place, if you can stay that long, and then leaving and going back to the place where you're normally based. This is happening more and more in the American news business. Where much of the globe, if you look at a map of the world, American news outlets, for the most part, have no bureaus in sub-Saharan Africa, in South America. Until the rise of China, very few in East Asia. So we're not covering much of the world. Now, they did empty out a lot of bureaus in Europe. There used to be a crazy situation where you had bureaus in London, Paris, Bonn, Moscow, Rome, and Jerusalem, which, let's face it, is a pretty small slice of the world, and none on the African continent, and none south of Dallas. But you had a bunch in that small concentrated area of Western Europe and the Eastern Mediterranean.
You're not complaining about the Rome assignment, though.
No, the Rome assignment worked out. We were the only bureau in the CBS constellation that actually had a wine budget. So it was a good bureau to work in, and I treasure my time there. But I don't think anybody has a fully staffed permanent Rome bureau anymore. Part of that was John Paul II and the final chapters of the Cold War, and it was felt to be an important place to be. But a lot of it's just money now.
Mm-hmm. So, well, let's talk about the financing of the news, or stay with the financing of the news business. When you were at the NewsHour, you did some really terrific coverage of the issue of global health. And that was enabled by a Gates Foundation grant. And the NewsHour is also been covering the role of social entrepreneurs, which is a fascinating phenomenon, and very interesting that a major news outlet would be taking this on. That was financed by a Skoll Foundation grant. Should we worry, even though those are things we'd probably all are thrilled about, should we worry about a situation in which the folks with resources can determine the priorities of news coverage?
That's a very, very difficult question, because the NewsHour was running on fumes for much of the time that I was there, but it really got bad after the recession started. And a lot of the family foundations and philanthropic organizations that gave us untied money, that is, money that was just used to sustain the program and finance its coverage, that went away. And when money started to flow in again, it was tied money, mm-hmm. as you note, given to cover specific areas of the world, specific issues, specific stories. And that puts a news organization, I think, in peril. The degree to which you control your money, because your money is a proxy for your editorial decision making. If you're covering things that you normally wouldn't cover, because you have the money to do it, given by someone who's demanded that you use it in a specific way, and you're not covering things that you want to cover but you can't afford, you're in a very tight spot. And I hope I'm not telling tales out of school, but we talked about this a lot at the program, and we did what we could to build in a lot of arm's lengths. There were all kinds of arms of varying lengths in between us and Bill and Melinda Gates, between us and Jeff Skoll. We were not taking orders from central office. We really stayed very independent, and part of the terms was that we would have independent overseers for some of this money so that they would be part of our editorial consultation process. Not Bill and Melinda on a conference call, but people who were worldwide experts in the area of global health talking to us about what the pressing problems and what the challenging issues were, so that we had another layer a filter in between us and the source of the money. We were honest, we were straight, but when an organization's in financial trouble, it starts to look like pay to play, and that's the last thing you want it to look like.
I should note that the cost of Margaret Warner's overseas coverage, for example, budget in a given year is like $250,000. I mean, it's not, I may be wrong on that, but it's not mammoth. You don't have to be Bill and Melinda Gates. You can be a group of citizens who believe we should have international coverage, period. Not directing what it is, but and make that possible. And so in many ways, you know, answering that phone call, you know, responding to the drive for funds can make that kind of huge
difference.
Absolutely. And keep the funding diversified.
And Margaret's doing the kind of reporting, I should say, since you mentioned her by name, that you just cannot see anywhere in American commercial broadcasting, with the possible exception of Al Jazeera America. But you won't see it on the three big network newscasts.
Yeah. Let me take you to a subject that you have been covering at Al Jazeera and America, and has been a focus of conversation here. Well, there are two of them, really, Ukraine and Syria. But let's start with Ukraine. As we were walking in, you gave me the latest news on what's happening there. And I'd like to sort of take you, both share the latest news and take you further and ask you to give me your sense, give us your sense of Russia's interests, our interests, and where they collide.
In the last several hours, Russian forces have moved outside the border of Ukraine, of Crimea, into Ukraine's national territory and taken over gas works. This is a pretty audacious thing, especially since all along so much of the focus was on Crimea alone. Now they're on the national territory of Ukraine. It's a really big escalation, especially given the state of play and tomorrow's referendum. So stay tuned. It's really something. When I was in Russia after the fall of the Soviet Union, I saw a beaten down, demoralized, almost shell-shocked country. And these were people who, until just a short time before, thought they were one of the most powerful peoples in the world, because that's what they were told. but as the channels of communication made Russia a much more porous society, they realized that they were poorer than East Germans, poorer than Hungarians. They were not well supplied in anything except missiles and jets. A country that couldn't make mass produce a toaster had fabulous intercontinental missiles. It was a great reporting trip I got to do during the early 90s to talk to people who found themselves on the wrong sides or the surprising sides of borders. Russians who lived in Uzbekistan and still thought they were Russians. Uzbeks who lived in Moscow and wondered whether they should stay in the new Russia or go back home. Russian people who were ethnically Russian, living in Riga, Latvia, who were incensed that there was a new law that would require them and their children to learn Latvian. And when I was talking to these people, I assumed from the tenor of our conversation that they were people who had moved to Latvia from Russia. So I said, well, where do you come from originally? And the guy said to the translator, I was born right here in Riga. And I said, wait a minute, you said you were 45 years old. He says, yeah. I said, and you don't know a single word of Latvian? No. And he was outraged that he would have to. The fall of the Soviet Union, we should be reminded now, especially now, given the state of play in Ukraine, was a messy, haphazard affair, which left all kinds of people feeling they were in the wrong place, including a lot of Russian nationals and Russian speakers, people who were ethnically Russian, people who were Russian here in the great theater in between their ears. And the accident of history of Khrushchev, who had been the Communist Party chief in Ukraine, giving Crimea as a gift to the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, the fictional separate country, that set the stage for today. You've had to learn a lot to keep up with this story, haven't you? I mean, just in the last couple of weeks, like, why is Crimea in Ukraine and not in Russia? What's the Black Sea Fleet doing docking in Ukraine and not docking in a Russian port? And on and on and on. It's peculiar. It's damn peculiar because of the peculiar history that led up to it. The pipelines that supply much of Western Europe with natural gas run through Ukraine. And Ukraine is itself almost totally reliant on Russia for natural gas and was plunged into the dark 5 years ago when there was a dispute over the contracts and the money for natural gas. And Ukrainian winters, I'm sure you've seen on TV, they can be rugged, tougher than spending the winter here. And when the natural gas taps got closed, they had to go through brownouts and stop using heat, home heat, and it was really something. And it was a reminder that Russia still has a proprietary interest, or what it sees as a proprietary interest, in what it calls the near abroad, countries that used to be part of the Soviet Union, that border the Soviet Union, that were once under the sway of Moscow governments. They haven't stopped being interested in these places just because they're separate countries now. And Vladimir Putin, who's called the breakup of the Soviet Union one of the greatest calamities of the 20th century. You might have thought World War II was, or World War I, or the massacre of the Armenians, or something. But no, the breakup of the Soviet Union, one of the greatest geopolitical calamities of the 20th century. If you know that Vladimir Putin thinks that, none of this should be a surprise.
So we tend to think of, well, let me just sort of ask you about the uprising that brought down Yanukovych, that created this, led to this crisis to begin with. Was that a leaderless revolution?
No. One of its leaders was in jail, Yulia Tymoshenko. One of its leaders is a former heavyweight championship contender, Klitschko, and a raft of parties. including both pro-European and Western-oriented parties, young educated people, technocrats, but also Ukrainian chauvinists and people who, long before the breakup of the Soviet Union, would have wanted Ukraine to go its own way, for Russian to stop being a medium of instruction in schools, to hear the language disappear from the national broadcasting, and so on. It's a broad coalition with many diverse interests, but I wouldn't call it leaderless. No, the man who's now the interim prime minister was one of the leaders in the Maidan, talking to the crowds at night as they warm their hands over empty oil drums. So if anything, they've got too many leaders right now. It's a very interesting time in Kiev as everybody's jockeying for position for what happens when the dust settles.
But unlike Egypt, for example, is this a situation where there are people prepared to govern?
Ukraine has been governed pretty badly since 1991. And it remains to be seen whether some of these people, if they had their way, I mean, Yulia Tymoshenko, she was no great shakes when she was running Ukraine. And if she or one of her proteges becomes the next permanent prime minister when there are national elections, there's certainly no guarantee. This strengthens Russia's hand and weakens the West's hand. That an independent Ukraine was a kleptocracy, fabulous amounts of money have disappeared into who knows where and probably into European banks. Industry was run poorly and inefficiently, living on subsidies. It was not what you'd call a functioning country, and then there was this recent tumult and recent unpleasantness. This has been a country where people are poorer than they should be, based on Ukraine's resources and the social capital in its people, fairly well-educated, high rates of literacy. And they know that people all around them are not as poor as they are. Poland, a country Ukraine pays a lot of attention to because what used to be Western Ukraine is now Eastern Poland. I mean, there's a great deal of cultural familiarity there. They know that the Poles, since 1991, have doubled in wealth while they are roughly at the same inflation-adjusted GDP per capita that they were when the Soviet Union broke up. So it's a restless, dissatisfied, and unsure people that's now trying to figure out its next move.
Let me take you from a hard problem to a very hard problem, and that's Syria, where you've also covered. We've got a question card here asking what you would do. Let me just see, what are your opinions? You're lucky, you're only getting asked for your opinions as opposed to what you would do. What are your opinions regarding the Syrian refugee crisis? And another questioner noted that there are going to be national elections in June or July in Syria. What does that mean in the face of a civil war on the one hand and talks about transitional governments on the other?
Well, I can't give you my opinion. You understand that, right? But I can give you observations that I think are useful to these questions. None of Syria's neighboring countries have the wherewithal to respond to the refugee crisis on their own. So either the world has to really step up and take care of this in a much more serious way, or we have to be at peace with the notion that bad things are going to start happening in those camps too. You can't have 2 million people living in temporary refugee camps for a long time. It's bad national policy, it's bad international policy, and bad things start to happen in those places, both socially. You're going to raise a generation of Syrian kids improperly and insufficiently educated, unable to help rebuild a shattered country when those people can go back home. There's going to be disease. There's going to be rape and the exploitation of women and girls. Just when you rip people out of the places they call home and put them in 10,000 tents, even if you're giving them three meals a day and clean water and the sort of basics to keep themselves alive, it's a much depleted people that goes home, if they go home. And let's remember that there are people still living in Palestinian refugee camps, 66 years after the 1948 war. Complex reasons why, but we also have to recognize that there are places in the world where refugee camps have become permanent cities. There's one, the largest one in the world right now is in northern Kenya, where tens of thousands of Somalis live, and there's no prospect for getting them out of there. They destabilize the countries they move into. I mean, you want to see somebody who's worried, look at King Abdullah of Jordan, who now has suddenly hundreds of thousands of needy citizens living on his borders that he has no idea when they're leaving, no idea what's going on and who are the men in these camps. It's a tough situation.
So you're saying of Syrians on top of the very many Palestinians in Jordan.
Right. And certainly Lebanon is not such a stable country that it can bear having a couple of hundred thousand foreigners living near its, on its national territory, near its border with its historically overbearing neighbor, Syria. Turkey is an interesting case because the Turks really looked like they were going to start punching their weight on the international stage. And you might remember that just before Syria really descended into this chaotic bloodletting, Erdogan was making a tour of the Eastern Mediterranean, and people were writing editorials in the Arab press about neo-Ottomanism and all that. But that fear was fueled by the fact that Turkey suddenly is part of the global middle class and has a big wealth-creating economy that the Syrians and the Lebanese and the Jordanians can only look at in awe. They can't do anything remotely like that. So it's a tough neighborhood. It's a bad situation. You've got a guy who is only going to be carried out of his office feet first, and he has 10,000 very heavily dug in, wealthy, influential people who depend on him. They believe that after he goes, their goose is cooked. Whether they're right or not, if they really believe it, even if they don't like him, they're going to do everything they can to keep him around. He has convinced various Syrian minority populations that after he goes, there'll be nobody to protect them from jihadis. And their churches are going to be dynamited, and the Druzim are going to be driven out of the country, and life gets really bad if you're a member of a Syrian minority, is what he's been telling them. And certainly the Alawites, his own ethnic group, his own religious group, are terrified what happens after he goes. So he may look from here in the St. Regis, as one of the worst human beings on the planet, and he may very well be. But there are thousands of people with what they perceive as a tremendously high stake in keeping him around, even though it looks like the country's going to be torn limb from limb for the foreseeable future. It's a terrible situation. And Ukraine has taken the eyes of the world off Syria for the past 2 weeks, and Assad has had a free hand in a way he doesn't usually have, and it's been really rough on civilian populations in Syria for the last couple of weeks.
And several of the question cards point to other parts of the world, like South Sudan, and several parts of the world where you're seeing populations fleeing very violent situations without a solution.
South Sudan is such a tragedy. It's really a tragedy. Here's a place with tremendous oil deposits, a place where people of various ethnic groups fought shoulder to shoulder because they all had a common enemy. Mm-hmm. Then they finally get what they want after decades of struggle, and now they're fighting each other. It's really, really heartbreaking. Because who suffers the worst? It's those families that are being driven out of their towns and into the countryside with no means of support. The people who are going to die in bunches until a working government is able to run the place from Juba. Terrible.
Let's hang on to the notion of mobile populations, but not so much populations fleeing from, so much as populations drawn to, and turn to the question of of Latinos of America in America.
Nicely done, by the way. That's a good pivot.
Good on the segue here. Give us a sense of the dimensions. What proportion of Americans, or what proportions of our population, we don't have to get into whether or not citizen, are Latinos?
1 out of 6. Let's sit with that. Let's marinate in that for a while. 1 out of 6. It's really remarkable. And I don't think, you know, even the numbers people at the Pew Hispanic Center, who are very good watchers of demographic trends and they understand state trends, they had an office pool. And all the demographers at the Pew Hispanic Center put a number into a hat. And you may remember the Census Bureau released its results 3 states at a time in 17 consecutive weeks. And I know some of you are saying, hey, that adds up to 51. My home, the District of Columbia, was number 51. And what they noticed, each week, 3 new states would come in, and every single one came in over the whisper number, over the number that they had projected. And not just the obvious states, the Texases and the Floridas and the Californias, but the North Dakotas and the North Carolinas and the Connecticuts were coming in well over what the consensus projections had been. Only one person in the office picked a number over 50 million, and in 2010 it was 50.5 million. Now it's roughly 53 million out of roughly 315 million Americans. 1 out of 6 people in this country traces their ancestry to the Spanish Empire in the Western Hemisphere. It's an amazing number.
As we think about Latino Americans, we think about them not as a monolith. And we think of Cuban Americans, of Mexican Americans, Central Americans, Puerto Rico Americans, or Puerto Ricans are Americans, but Latinos in Puerto Rico are from Puerto Rico. Talk about the differences, but also the question of whether there's a sense of commonalities as well.
There are differences, but the longer you're here, the less they matter. And there is also an American Latino culture that is developing here that is different and distinct from the life that's lived in Monterrey in Mexico City, or San Juan, or Caracas, or anywhere else in the rest of the hemisphere. It's an American Latino culture. So when I was a kid, if you turned on Spanish radio in New York, where I grew up, you heard Caribbean music, played by Puerto Rican and Cuban musicians, mostly. And that was what you heard there. And when you got off the plane in Los Angeles and got into your rental car and turned on the radio and went down to the other end of the dial, what you heard was various regional Mexican musics. Period. That world of just Mexicans in Southern California and just Caribbeans in New York and just Cubans in Miami, that's a gone world like it never even existed. It's a historical relic of our understanding this population. The majority of Latinos in South Florida are no longer Cuban. In the 2020 census, Puerto Ricans won't be the single largest Latino group in New York City. Dominicans will be. And in places like Houston, and even in Miami, the largest group of new arrivals is no longer Mexicans and Cubans, but Central Americans, mostly Salvadorans, but certainly other people as well. And then once you grow up and then you have kids, those kids self-identify, but they are not Honduran and they're not Mexican. They're kids from Chicago and New York and Miami and Dallas, and they grow up in an American Latino culture. In the days when I was a teenager listening to the Fania All-Stars, they knew, Ruben Blades and Tommy Olivencia and all these various groups, they wouldn't go to Los Angeles because nobody would come see them. If they rented a theater and they put their name up on the marquee, they wouldn't sell any tickets and nobody would go see it. Juan Luis Guerra is a great Dominican superstar. And there are not many Dominicans to speak of in Chicago, tiny population. But now when Juan Luis Guerra goes and plays the Rosemont Horizon outside O'Hare Airport, 17,500 seats, it sells out in 3 hours. Nobody says, oh, I don't want to hear him. I'm not Dominican. He is a Latino superstar to Mexican kids and Puerto Rican kids and Dominican kids and all kinds of kids, because there is an American Latino culture that's distinct from what's going on back home. Watch here. Here's your homework. When you go home, after we're done here, turn on Sábado Gigante. Sábado Gigante is on every Saturday night, hence the name, and it's hosted by a Chilean Jew named Mario Luis Kreutzberger. And it's imagine that Ted Mack original Amateur Hour and the Ed Sullivan Show and Barnum and Bailey's Circus were traveling in three separate trucks down the road and crashed into each other at an intersection. That's Sábado Gigante. And he's sort of the ringleader, Don Francisco, as he's called. And the people in the audience live in Florida. They're not people, foreign people. They are people who live and work and pay taxes and raise their kids and drive their cars and gas up in Florida, and visitors from other places. And they are Caribbean, and they're Central American, and they're South American, and they speak with the accents of all these places. And he has a torchy salsa singer, then goes to a commercial break, and then there's a mariachi band at the bottom of the next half hour, then there's a talent show competition. He makes fun of the accents of people from different places. Then they sing jingles for American products that are not sold in Latin America. So the only way they could know those jingles is because they're American, for Tide and Whisk and you know, that kind of stuff. It is an American show in Spanish. And nobody's sitting in the stands cheering for Don Francisco or applauding for the talent show mariachi band saying, oh, I'm Mexican and they're Mexican, so I'm for them. It's not about that anymore. It's so far beyond that now. And my daughter, in a remarkable, transformative, shows you how transformative a country America is. My daughter rose Varsity Crew. And you know, if you had asked me when I was a kid growing up in Brooklyn if I would ever be related to someone who rode Varsity Crew, I would have told you no.
Maybe polo, but not Varsity Crew.
Absolutely. Polo, sure. After I finished a game of Baccarat, I'd head out for a chukka or two. Her team, that won the citywide championship last year consists of little half Puerto Rican her, Cuban kid, a Salvadoran kid, and a kid whose father comes from Spain. Probably all their parents are surprised they're rowing varsity crew, but if you ask them what they are, they say, we're Latinas. They don't say, oh, I'm El Salvador and she's Cuban and blah, blah, blah. They just say, we're Latinas. And they're very comfortable, unconflicted. They don't say, oh, but don't think of us as a monolith. They don't care about that stuff. And when it comes time for them to vote, she's 14, they're not going to care about that stuff then. They're going to care about who cares about people like me. And that's what politicians who pay consultants to explain to them the difference between a Salvadoran and a Dominican are in some senses wasting their money, because there's no difference between a crummy school filled with Salvadoran children and a crummy school filled with Dominican children in the South Bronx. And there's no difference between a crummy house in the Upper West Side of Manhattan and a crummy house in Dallas. And there's no difference between a divided family with some members in fear of deportation, depending on where they're going to be deported to. They both have that fear, they both have that concern. And even though the vast majority of Latinos in the United States don't have anybody who fears deportation or anything like it, the sociologist Gary Segura, a political scientist nearby down the road in Palo Alto, says that he calls it a threshold issue for Latinos. It's not necessarily one that affects them directly, but it's one that they understand completely and can make political decisions around, because they use it as sort of an acid test. You know, that's why you see Puerto Rican flags at immigration demonstrations. Nobody's going to be sent home unless they want to go home. But they're showing solidarity. And I saw those flags in the big May Day marches in Philadelphia, New York, and Chicago, but I've seen them all over the country. This cuts across all ethnic and national origin boundaries. Even Cubans use it as a threshold issue, even though none of them are going to get sent home either. And they are alone among Latinos, outside of Puerto Ricans who are American citizens, in having status the moment they arrive, no questions asked, and access to the social welfare system. It's a totally different story for Cubans, yet they look at it as a threshold issue.
And so how come we can't get an immigration reform bill passed?
I did a 30 report series on the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986. I watched as it rolled out, the PSA campaigns, the sign-ups, the English language classes and citizenship classes. I was so steeped in that law. And the way it was structured, it was supposed to make sure that we never ended up with millions of undocumented citizens people working in the country again. It said, okay, we will take these people in, we will wave a wand over them and make them legal, but we're not going to do this again, so we're going to set up a new enforcement system. And it was a very heavily employer-based enforcement system. But what do employers whose livelihoods depend on these workers do? They call first the INS, then their congressman, and say, get these people off my backs. You're putting me out of business. And in Congress after Congress, the enforcement budget of the Immigration and Naturalization Service was reduced or kept flat while the problem burgeoned. So more and more people came because there was more and more work to do and more people who would put them to work. So we discuss immigration as if it's an immigrant-based problem, when from day one it's been an employer-based problem. Nobody comes here, and you can interview border agents, which I have year after year. When they pick people up in the desert, they know where they're going and they know what they're going to do when they get there. No one that they pick up says, I think I'm going to Denver, and I don't know what I'm going to do when I get there. They know exactly what they're going, where they're going. They have cell phone numbers. They have addresses. This is a very efficient bush telegraph that operates up and down the hemisphere of people on the move looking for where there's economic opportunity. And as long as there were American bosses to hire them, more people came. And we might try to persuade ourselves that the problem is some other thing. As many people said during the 2012 election campaign, people coming for free stuff. It was people coming to go to work and work at some of the crappiest jobs in North America for some of the lowest pay in North America. And as long as people kept hiring them, they kept coming. That's where you fix that problem. But now that there are 11 million people here, there aren't enough buses or planes in this country to send 11 million people anywhere. I once asked a panel of Republican presidential candidates, I said, let me ask you gentlemen a two-part question. Whether it's A, desirable, and B, practical to try to send back, and it was then 12 million people. So I said, okay, first A, desirable, and I knew they would all raise their hands. So they all raised their hands. Then I said, B, practical, and I assumed, silly me, that they wouldn't all say that it was practical, but they all said it was practical. So as long as we are beholden to this, these ideas in sort of theological ways rather than policy design ways, we're never going to work our way out of this. As long as people who know that we have to solve this problem see solving it as a victory for somebody else and not for them, and certainly not for the country, then we're not going to solve it. They think this is a win for somebody else, the people who are most adamantly opposed to it. And as long as they see it that way, as long as they don't see it as a win for themselves or their side or this country, this is just going to go on and on and on.
So let me hold on to one of the big policy experiments of our lifetimes, and that was NAFTA. And the notion there was that NAFTA would bring about prosperity in Mexico, thus reducing that pressure of folks moving north in search of employment, in search of jobs. What has been the net effect of NAFTA?
Well, first of all, on March 25th, I'm going to have the Canadian ambassador to the United States and the Mexican ambassador to the United States as my guests on Inside Story, and we're going to talk about what NAFTA has meant to Mexico and Canada, so I suggest you watch.
At 8:30.
On the 25th at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and if you miss it, which you might, or if you want to see it again, next morning at 8:30. It's a mixed bag. It has helped Canada tremendously, because Canada exports both finished and natural resources goods. It's got both in profusion, a very highly educated workforce, very productive industries. So whether they're making stuff or just pulling stuff out of the ground or chopping it down, it's been good for Canada because the United States is a voracious consumer of both finished goods and natural resources. Mexico, there's a new middle class in Mexico that wasn't there before. And don't kid yourself that Mexico is as poor as it was when NAFTA was passed. It's not. It's part of the new global middle class. It is a tremendous thing to see Mexican families on a Sunday afternoon coming out of Walmart and getting into their American-made pickup truck to drive home to a house that they own. It's wreaked havoc in the farming sector because it's upended a century or more, well, more actually, but a century of codified law around common farmland, the ejido system, which was swept away by NAFTA. Lots of people who made their living growing corn don't anymore. There's American corn and Mexican tortillas, but there's also Mexican tomatoes heading north during the seasons of the year when we can't grow them here. And there are Mexican millionaires and billionaires who were created by NAFTA, and factories popping up all over the northern states of Mexico, making both components for American finished goods and the finished goods themselves. There's a new industrial worker class in Mexico making Toyotas and making Fords and making Volkswagen Beetles. So it's brought tremendous change to all three countries. It hasn't gone as far as the people who dreamed it up in the first place imagined it would. You still can't drive a truck full of televisions from Monterrey to Chicago. You have to change drivers and change trucks somewhere along the way because Mexican truck drivers and Mexican trucks are not allowed to simply pass through where they're going. There's a lot of things that NAFTA promised, NAFTA hoped for, that haven't yet come true, but it has made a lot of people richer. It's made a lot of things you buy in the United States cheaper. It has meant, in many industries, the giant sucking sound that was promised during the 1992 election. And a lot of industries, I mean, one of the saddest stories I did in my years as a reporter in Chicago was covering the meeting where they told picture tube workers in Maywood, Illinois, just outside the city lines, that all that picture tube production was going to Mexico. And the jobs that had provided for their homes, sent their kids to college, and created their prosperity in a way that they never could have imagined would be impossible for their own children. So it's a very mixed bag.
I'll give you 1 minute to answer this question, and that is, have there been key cultural moments that have contributed to that sense of being a Latino, an American Latino, contributed to that togetherness, a sort of Desi Arnaz on TV kind of moment?
Well, you know, I'm glad you brought up Desi Arnaz because...
Is anybody here old enough for I Love Lucy? Okay.
Desi Arnaz, you know, that was the picture of Lucy and Desi with little Ricky on the front cover of TV Guide was the largest selling issue of TV Guide in history. The idea of a Cuban band leader marrying a redhead from upstate New York, if he was a couple of shades darker, it probably wouldn't have been as comfortable for Americans as it was in 1952 to see very handsome, very telegenic Desi Arnaz. It was very funny to watch it in my house, because when he would yell at her, we knew what he was saying. And the joke for us was that all the other people didn't know what he was saying. And when he sang Babalu, remember Babalu? Babalu is a very interesting song about a syncretic Afro-Caribbean religion called Santeria. And it's a man who's been unlucky in wealth and unlucky in love, about to perform a ceremony, like magic, putting out candles and rum and tobacco for Babalu, who is a West African god, but he lives in the Caribbean under the guise of a Roman Catholic saint. This way, the slaves who still practiced the West African religion could keep these santos in their house and not be punished by the masters, who would suspect that they hadn't made a full and open-hearted conversion to Catholicism. So this is like 400 years of very deep Caribbean stuff going on here. And then there's Lucy, who throws on Desi's conga and sings. She doesn't know any of the words. She just yells, Babalu, Babalu, and she just hits the thing. And that's one of those moments where you think, okay, we're here, that's great, we're here. I mean, but there's still a lot that America's not gonna get about us for a while. And so those breakthrough moments happen from time to time, and they are a lot of fun. When Ricky Martin gets up on the stage at the inaugural party in 2000, before George Bush's inauguration, and you think, here's Ricky Martin Here's Ricky Martin, who can't even vote in presidential elections, up on the stage dancing with George Bush. Do the people who know that he's Ricky Martin and he's dancing with George Bush know that he can't vote in presidential elections because he lives in Puerto Rico? I don't know. I mean, Stephen Sondheim wrote now 55 years ago, nobody knows in America, Puerto Rico's in America. One of the things I write about in the book is that even though we've been here living side by side with the Anglo-American world, we're strangers in a way that America should be embarrassed about and isn't, and doesn't even know that it should be embarrassed about. That the common run of Americans, and I'm not putting people down, it's the way we're educated, it's the way we're acculturated, that the average American knows so little about the Spanish past of the United States is an embarrassment. It's you know, when grumpy Protestants with buckle shoes and black hats landed in Massachusetts, St. Augustine was already 100 years old. And Santa Fe was already established as the capital of a northern Spanish colony. This idea that it's just this English thing that pushed west from Plymouth and Jamestown to where we're sitting today, just a couple of miles from the Mission Church of San Francisco, it's really a loss to Americans that they don't know about this fabulous, rich history. They don't know that while they're worried about the quote-unquote invasion over the border, Mariano Vallejo was worried about the invasion over his border of Americans heading west who would eventually throw him in jail and steal his land. So Californians, you guys know all this stuff. But but there'll be stuff in this book that even you don't know.
So please join me in thanking Ray Suarez.
Thank you. Thank you.